Every April, they roam the grounds of one of the country's most prestigious universities. 35 years ago or so, you might have seen one of them, known among his secretive friends as Temporary. Our number one story in the countdown: if Temporary winds up losing the presidential election this fall, that name is going to haunt him the rest of his life. Temporary. His name in the Yale University Secret Society Skull and Bones, better known to you as President George Bush. Now, for the first time in the history of that Yale club, two of its former members will go head-to-head for the presidency. Also the first time in the history of that slightly less secretive organization, the United States of America. That's right, John Kerry was also in Skull and Bones. In a moment, a journalist at Yale who has removed some of the unknowns from the bones. First, who are these people? Skull and Bones dates to 1832. It was, in fact, a reaction to a secret society, the Masons, then much more influential than they are today. Founder William Huntington Russell thought of his little conclave as sort of anti-Masons, and as a home for the wealthy and the powerful and the people who would do anything for another Bonesman. Each year, 15 Yale undergraduate seniors are tapped for membership, initiated in controversial, murky fashion, fashion dramatized here in the movie The Skull.
Skull above any other. Say it.
Fashion satirized here in The Simpsons.
Who is Atlantis off the maps? Who keeps the Martians on their rafts?
We do.
Members of Skull and Bones, that is, not of the Stonecutters, gather on High Street in the Yale campus at the Tomb. New members, the Neophytes, are expected to do things like lie in coffins and wrestle in mud and kiss a skull and confess their sexual histories in front of the group to bond themselves together further still, and presumably just for a few laughs. Once you're in, you're in. Skull and Bones is for life. Talking about Skull and Bones is for others. And there are a lot of Bonesmen who did not talk, but did succeed. Henry Luce, who created Time Magazine and all its cousins. Harold Stanley, founder of Morgan Stanley. Henry Louis Stimson, the Secretary of War under FDR and Truman. William F. Buckley. Averill Harriman, longtime governor of New York. And then there are the presidents. William Howard Taft, whose father Alfonso had helped found the group and whose son Robert was a senator. George Herbert Walker Bush, whose father Prescott was a Bonesman and a senator. The current President Bush, although his kid at Yale has not been tapped for Skull and Bones, even though they do admit women now. His child is not Skull and Bones, his opponent is. John Kerry, Bonesman, class of 66. And if this needs to be weirder for you, try this. His wife, Teresa's first husband, the late senator from Pennsylvania, John Hines. His father was Skull and Bones. So we have an all-secret society presidential election. Not that either of them are talking about it.
You both were members of Skull and Bones, a secret society at Yale. What does that tell us?
Not much, because it's a secret.
You were both in Skull and Bones, the secret society.
It's so secret we can't talk about it.
One a Democrat, one a Republican, miles apart on the issues, but both rooted in the same secret Yale society. Which raises the question, how exactly is the Bush bone connected to the Kerry bone? Joining us now to talk about the bones connection is Alexandra Robbins, author of Secrets of the Tomb, Skull and Bones, the Ivy League and the Hidden Paths of Power. She's also a Yale alum and, in the interest of full disclosure, a member of another Yale secret society. Ms. Robbins, good evening.
Hi, I was a member, but they won't talk to me anymore since my book was published.
Congratulations.
I guess.
Cornell 79 here, we don't know squat about secret society, so we just go from there. We know from your feature in The Atlantic that the George W. Bush was assigned the temporary name, Temporary, and just kept it. What do we know what John Kerry's Skull and Bones name was?
We don't. We can probably assume that he received the assigned name Long Devil, which is the name for the tallest member of the club, but I'm just guessing.
There seems to be no middle ground about this organization. Either the group is viewed as the warm-up act for the Trilateral Commission, or it is a society devoted to making people think that it's nefarious and then giggling when people take it seriously. Which is it closer to being?
It's actually closer to the middle ground. There are conspiracy theories that you'll hear that are based on nuggets of truth, for example. They really do tell their sexual histories. That's something that both Bush and Kerry would have done. The sole purpose of Skull and Bones is to get members into positions of power, and then to have those members hire other members to prominent positions, which is something that President Bush has done. Basically, this is probably the most powerful and elite alumni network in the country, and that's the significance of Skull and Bones.
Well, what happens when two bonesmen are in conflict, like, say, if they run against each other for president? Are there rules of conduct among bonesmen to cover this?
I've actually asked members of Skull and Bones what happens if it's a Bush-Kerry election. They told me they don't care. It's a win-win situation for Skull and Bones.
So there is no instruction, and there's nothing that prevents, obviously there's nothing that would prevent Kerry from running against the sitting bonesman. And this is a secret society with all these rules and help your fellow bonesmen up until a point.
Well, this is an organization that's basically one huge superiority complex, and they're just thrilled to have Bonesman running against Bonesman, because that means that no matter who wins, there's going to be a connection in the White House for them.
And if we broke into that place on High Street in New Haven, Connecticut, we would see what?
Oh,
something
gosh.
That looked like a Harry Potter adventure ride at an amusement park?
Something like that. You'd see dozens of skulls, skeletons, art celebrating death, war memorabilia, and several allegedly stolen items that Bonesmen supposedly were supposed to take as gifts to the society's goddess. I'm not making this up.
And what happened to her?
Well, according to Skull and Bones legend, in 322 BC, which is why you see the number 322 associated with Bones, the Greek orator Demosthenes died. When he died, the goddess Eulogia, whom Skull and Bones calls the goddess of eloquence, arose to the heavens, and she didn't happen to come back down again until 1832. Again until 1832, when Russell formed Skull and Bones. So now everything in the society is done in deference to this goddess. They have sacred anthems to her, they have a shrine to her, and they're supposedly encouraged to go steal things and bring them back to her in the tomb.
Now I get it. At Cornell, we just stole things for the hell of it. Alexandra Robbins, author of Secrets of the Tomb, many thanks. Appreciate it. One more thing you need to know about tonight's number one story: the amount of money that members of Skull and Bones are rumored to get when they graduate from Yale, $15,000. Although, this Robbins magazine article concludes by quoting one of Mr. Bush's contemporaries as saying, "I'm still waiting for mine."